First check of my eye. Our guest today, speaker today, is Sahasa G, and she's going to speak to us on the acceptance of reality.
Tell us in on, come on. That song is, says it all for me. Master has told me what to do, how to be happy, what it takes. And so I'm gonna talk about why I haven't done that yet, I guess, to whatever degree I can, and what I need to do to do it.
Right.
So acceptance of reality is what he said in this last workshop was really what being self-realized is about, being able to abide in that condition. So obviously I'm not in acceptance of reality and I'm working to that point. But so this is going to be very loose, as I'm just talking based on where I'm at, talking based on what I've seen. And he told me last night, said Master called me, and he reminded me that the happiness I'm looking for is already the case. It's there. There's no place to look for it outside. There's nothing out here that could ever give it to me. It's been waiting for me, he says, like it's pacing, like a pacing person, just waiting inside for me to come and get it. And he said that I've given about 12 or 13 different arguments for my insanity, you know, over the years, you know, and that I'm still, I'm still not sane, you know, that I have done a good job at describing my condition, but not prescribing it. So I had to think about that. I said, well, how can I prescribe it? If I was well person, then I could prescribe it, but I'm not well. I can't prescribe it. You know, I'm not able to do that, you know. So I had to kind of, he said, you need to, you know, go into this thing. And so, you know, I decided reluctantly, of course, to look deeper at this inability to accept reality. And he said that my original idea of addressing the major categories of conditional reality, because I just saw the workshop tape this to finish it up on Tuesday. So I'm getting all my categories down, and age and suffering and aging and sickness and death and getting what I want and people and clinging and avoidance. I was just going to take all those and break it. He said, no, you're just describing something, you know. And so he said that was not deep enough. So I'm still not sure, like I said, if I'm going to be able to do as he's instructed, but I will talk about my ignorance and what it will take to achieve Mosca, because that, I know, really is the only thing, you know, this life is about. So there is something in me that is still very fearful, though. Clearly, if I haven't attained, I'm fearful, and there are some things that I think that I have worked on and changed, and certainly since I was initiated November of 1993, I'm really reluctant, okay? November 1993. I recommitted, got a basic practice in September 2002. And even to do that, as you know, to get a basic practice, it takes some things you gotta give up. You gotta change some stuff, you know what I mean? You're hitting and missing and sometimes, and not, that means you're not able, I was not able to give up some things, or did not understand what I needed to do to even have a basic practice. So having that, I feel like, well, you know, it's 8 years almost, well, not quite eight, it was about 7.5 years later, and I'm feeling like I've given up a lot. I've tailored my life, you know, I've done a lot of things. So my little things that I'm still reluctant at, I mean, those are just my little thing, you know, little simple pleasures. I can still get up on time. I can still sit. You know, I can still do all my simmering throughout the day, try to be a first-class human being, all that. But, I mean, I don't have really many vices. You know what I mean? I can just go ahead and, you know, if I want to indulge in the TV a little bit or shop a little bit, you know, that's all. I can do that. You know, that. But Master said, no, it takes everything. So I've been reluctant, really, quite frankly. I've been reluctant. And to really give it everything. And there's some reasons for that reluctance. But, you know, these strategies have been futile. And I, you know, look at this reluctance and said, okay, well, I have to accept some things. And the opposite of that is to accept some things about reality. So the list of considerations that I desire to be other than the way that I, the way that reality dictates, you know, I was lining those up and looking and reflecting. And I looked, you know, this yesterday and today, I said, well, doggone it, they really are kind of recycled strategies. They're not any really anything new. It's not a lot new out there. You can do what new is out there to try to do. I mean we see. So for me, what I realized was, now I'm finally warming up, what I realized is that I have achieved, really, almost, Master said, well, you know, you get these things and then you don't get them, you don't get them for what you wanted them for. You get them and they don't do what you wanted them to do. And so in reflection, I said, well, they didn't make me happy. True, you know, I'm pursuing doing things and expecting a different result. So I'm recycling. That's insanity. Like you said, that is craziness. If I'm still doing it, it didn't produce it the first time. Why is it going to produce it the second time? Even if I change the dot, the I differently, or change the color of it a little bit, change the person, you know, it's still not going to do it. So my fears and fear-based living, I have to overcome. And the concerns that I busy myself with, the concerns that I busy myself with are a part of reality. It is so. So basically what I'm saying is that I'm burdened with these burdens of concern, these worldly concerns. Those concerns are reality. Yeah, you know, I might not have people accepting me. Yes, I may not have recognition. Yes, the money, security, and all that might not be there. All of these things, that's reality. And so I have to really get with the fact that this is what's happening or may not happen, and live like that versus trying to maladapt or console myself. And my maladaption has been through shopping. So if I can't get something to be my way, not only is it an addiction, obviously, to shop, but it's maladaptive in that it produces more suffering. So if something didn't happen, didn't go the way I wanted it to go, or somebody didn't act the way I wanted them to act, or whatever, then I'm shopping to kind of get that off me, make myself feel better, all right? I'm making myself feel better by shopping. That's the rebooting, right? And then, but one of my concerns, one of the things that I wanted in my list of things to be other than the way they are, one of them was financial freedom. Well, I can't have financial freedom if I'm shopping up compulsively, continuing to create more bills that I have to pay and all this kind of thing. So I'm increasing my suffering by trying to console myself from the first thing, which was the reality of whatever it was that I couldn't get to be the way that I wanted it to be. So I cannot, some of the other things, I cannot maintain or preserve the way I looked when I was 25. Okay, so you need to accept that reality, okay? You're not gonna look like you looked when you were 25. You'll never look like that again, okay? If I can really accept that, that's gonna take a lot of time, mental energy, attention off of this infatuated state, off of this delusion about it, okay? Giving me more attention to free up and do my meditation, to do my sermon, to do my Dion. And another thing, I talked about the money. Having more money is not going to make me happy. There's been times when I've had more and I just shop more and indulge more, and you just make more problem. Okay. The other thing that I'm looking at, I'm not able to, I have a son, one son. Had one son, and this child that came through me, trying to make him satisfied and happy, ain't gonna happen. But I get confused, you know. I'm still, you know, thinking I can do, you know, to make him just so, you know, perfectly content and truly, you know, living up to his potential and doing all the things that, you know, I consider the ideal child or a happy child to do. So I can't do that. I don't care what I try, it's not going to work. I'm responsible for him, do the best I can, but I can't keep giving that so much attention, and particularly as it relates to trying to make somebody do and cooperate with me, meaning his dad, in my strategies to try to make this kid, you know, whole and healthy and all these kinds of ideals I have. So all of this stuff has to be accepted, and I realize that I'm not accepting those things. And better yet, I'm not accepting them, you know, one day I might accept something, but the next day, 10 days, I'm not. And I'm not because if I'm thinking about that, and that's another strategy for me, is to think, always be thinking, strategizing, ruminating. Well, if we're thinking in that way, which Master said before, that's not even really thinking. You know, you're not solving a problem at that very moment. You're just, you know, going on and on about it. And it's a worry or it's a rumination that is fantasy-based, you know, really. Because if you're trying to make a scenario that's not the scenario, that's not the reality, that's, you know, again, a suffering. So all these things I have, you know, I'm putting the microscope up now. I'm going to have to really look every moment, and I'm going to read something in Samyama about that again and just refresh my memory about it. We talked about it in 07. It's still the same. You know, everything he's saying is still the same. Other thing that I'm not accepting that's real, that I think will make me happy, companionship, a mate. Now, I've had that before. You know what I mean? Okay, see that you had that and see that that didn't do it. I do have a little different slant on it now since talking with Master in January, and I understand his practicality in terms of the path and my psychological or emotional health. But at the same time, I've got to find a balance in thinking about that and putting energy into finding or being in the right place or going to whatever to find a potential companion or mate. I got to keep that in bounds and not let it impede any type or part of my practice, particularly formal meditation. I mean, it's just formal meditation, whatever you're thinking about, that's what you hung up in. If your mind goes there, just look. You know, it's hard. Sometimes I don't want to look, you know, but I know. But to look deeper, like he's telling me, is something that, you know, I have not wanted to do because I know it's going to, the fear that is associated with it also is that I'm thinking, like he said so many times, and I've heard him say it, but I'm not really, you know, necessarily thinking that it applied to me or didn't think I had that problem, is that, you know, I'm thinking my life is going to look a different way. Okay, well, I can't, I'm not going to be able to stay up sometimes till 10 o'clock and watch TV on the rare occasion that I get to do that now. I'm not going to be able to do that. And I'm thinking that's going to be such a big, you know, deprivation. You know, I can't do that thing, you know. But in reality, it's not providing any happiness. It's just consoling me. It's not really providing any happiness for me. So I'm getting to that in this head to realize that, okay, this is what that's about. And you're going to have to, you know, look at these things and realize they're not deprivations. I'm already deprived. I'm not enlightened. That's the biggest deprivation I guess I can have. I'm not happy. So, the other thing, I look back at my satsang in 2003, the Trinity of Sadhana, and I talked about being able to be aware of something, then being able to accept it, and then transcending it. And it's not any different now than it was then. It just becomes deeper and deeper and deeper. So I'm aware now of this more subtle kind of resistance that I have, reluctance that I have, and fear, which I'm still going to talk about this fear, because this fear still boils down to my doubt. You know, if there's some doubt there, there's... Years ago, Master and I talked about this, doubt in really what in the Master, what he's telling me, that I can really do this thing. You know, I still kind of, in the deepest part of me, I have to say that I've always wanted this. Even when I was a little kid, that I had, at 10 and 11, I had questions about this matter of being a ego. I didn't know it was ego then, but what made me me and you you? That was always my question, but I never asked anyone because I never thought anybody had an answer to it, quite frankly. But now I understand all this making me me is this activity, this ego activity, this thing that's separating me, this thing that's making me not accept things as they are. And so I know that yearning has been there. He said it's been there. I do at a major level do understand that. But again, because I haven't attained it, like he said, there's some doubt, you know. Can I do it? Oh goodness, do I have enough time to get it done? Will I do it in this lifetime? Don't want to come back. Well, maybe I won't. You know, I mean, you know, you just, all these things, you know, go around in the head. I'm like, okay, so I've got to continue to press on despite that doubt. I need more faith, you know, I need more faith. I think I have a good amount, but I don't have enough, obviously. So, another thing he told me the other night. Oh gosh, he's funny. He talked about in a satsang in September. This is one of my past, back in 04. I got some stuff from 04 on here. And remember, if you remember those that were there, I think almost everybody, a lot of people here were there, about the divisions of strategies for your search of happiness. And I thought I was at least at stage 5 ego, or the 6, you know, ethics and religion. And he kind of, you know how he does in his way, you know. He said, well, beloved, you know, those stage 1, 2, and 3, that's money, food, and sex. That's the lower chakras. I said, I guess I'm still there then. I thought I was up a little higher, but apparently not. So, you know, that is where I want to get to. I got to get there to get to the next, which is the 7th stage, the spiritual stage. And I just have to be diligent. And really what I realize is that at every moment, even when I go into this mental habit or some scar of trying to figure something out, I got to, at that moment, know that is lackadristi. I am automatically going into a state that is not reality-based, and it's going to produce suffering. At every moment, I got to be like on it, like, I mean, you know, white on rice. I got to be right there with, and the only antidote, which he talks about, is Simran and Dion. So I'm going to read a little bit here, a couple pages from Samyama, The Cultivation of Supreme Understanding. He says the etiology of suffering. He says suffering is a feeling, and that feeling arises within our own mind upon contact with some aspect of objective reality, meaning that you know, doesn't change. Thus, suffering occurs in the mind. The task of any serious aspirant is to learn how to establish and maintain his or her mind in a state of no suffering. When our mind is in a state of suffering, we can't even concentrate. Therefore, no spiritual progress in meditation can be made. Hello. Our suffering does not arise until our mind comes into contact with some aspect of objective reality that we want to be other than the way it is. So, I mean, for everyone, I know I'm not worried about anybody else in this way, but in the sense that I'm sitting here, I challenge you, you know, look at every moment, you think about it, you almost want something to be other than the way it is. And when you realize that, if you can come far enough back and witness that process, that is when you got to get some dristi. You got to go for those 3 dristis and get into Simran right then, you know, Dion if you're able. But that's it. That's it. That is the practice. And it says our suffering does not arise until our mind comes into contact with some, oh, I already read that, aspect of what we do not want, what we want to be other than the way it is. When the mind makes contact with objective reality, feelings, sensations in the body-mind simultaneously arise. Thus, anger, you know, ill will, all these kinds of things. Now, I have had some personal victories in that area of watching anger pass or watching an emotion come and not identify with it. I'm not perfected in it, but I have watched, and that is a wonderful way to not suffer. Somebody or something happens, the body responds because the mind thought something first. You got to think something first for your body. You know, some people, if you're not able to get to the mental part, you're thinking, oh, I just got angry. But there was something right before that. So you got to go back. You got to back it up some more and look a little deeper and see what thought process happened that triggered that emotion or that bodily reaction, because the bodily reaction comes after the emotion. And so I have been able to actually pinpoint that from there to the body, I mean to the emotion, to the mind, and watch it go and not indulge in it. And it is a wonderful thing, I must say. But it's a practice, and I know that that is something I have to be even more diligent at. But see, the subtlety of the way this thing operates, this body-mind operates, you know, I'll go into just this mental kind of, you know, not realizing that's suffering too. Okay, so watch that go. Get that out of there. Get that out of there and go back to Simran and Dion. You know, you got to, I mean, it gets really, I mean, subtle and interesting, but that's the way he said, that's the way the Dharma has always said, do it. And when one desires, due to lack of drishti, reality to be other than the way it is, one then wants tana, something that one cannot have, a fantasy. That is, this is dukkha. It says, whenever our mind makes contact with objective reality, whatever our mind is associated with during the waking state, negative feelings arise, which in turn create a desire to avoid reality. So you either may want to avoid something, or you may want to cling to something. But it's whatever it is, it's something that's based on impermanence, and it's not gonna last, and will not make you happy. So we automatically generate a desire for that negative experience of reality not to be the case. And when a positive feeling arises, it creates a desire to cling and become attached to it. We want that pleasant feeling to last forever. Once we have created this desire for something to never change or end, we have set ourselves up for suffering. Afterwards, we look for all kinds of ways to relieve the suffering we created due to the lack of drishti for ourselves, i.e., for instance, the suffering I created, so I go, you know, relieve myself with some shopping or just more indulgent thinking. Then you got some more problems to deal with after that, or I do anyway. When we shut down feelings, negative or positive, and keep them from becoming a desire, as I was saying, you just watch it, keep it from becoming a desire for reality to be other than the way it is, we are able to maintain our mind in a state of no suffering. If we have not been able to fully cultivate wisdom mind, then at least the practice of our sadhana in that moment will enable us to throw these feelings out of our mind. And when we finally are able to attain and function in a state of jhana drishti, wisdom mind, our feelings based on wrong view are automatically extinguished upon contact with reality. So if you can maintain, if you can not do that, at least if you can, throw it off in that moment, you will maintain some level of non-suffering. So form, feelings, memory, and thought all arise from the contact of consciousness mind with reality. So at every moment, we're sitting here, we're formulating thoughts. We might be thinking about something else that's going on that we worried about, again, out of drishti, okay? Or you might be actually listening to what I'm saying. That's good too. But that kind of contact with consciousness and the mind is reality. However, we can handle any form of objective reality with our memory or thoughts, intelligence. Feelings, especially negative ones, as I have kind of highlighted, are not required to successfully handle problems. I need to read that a million times. Let me read that back to myself. Feelings, especially negative ones, which really is more for me about the thinking of it, are not required to successfully handle problems. We only think our negative feelings are necessary. This is due to lack of drishti. Our feelings are a warning system They're a warning system only, and their function is merely to alert us about the situation. So you might get alert, oh, ooh, I got something going on here, made me piss me off, or, okay, just alert you. But once we allow our feelings to escalate into a desire, okay, so this pissed me off, so now I want you to, or this or that, to be this way or not be that way. The desire was created, right? Okay? And in that moment, it says the reality of the moment, for the moment to be other than the way things are, it distorts reality, and then all of these, form, memory, and thought, are shut down, and we react out of blind passion. This is suffering and dukkha. Okay? So when our mind makes contact with reality, it produces various feelings, sensations. And when we create our own version of reality, the world, based on our own, not others' feelings, samsara, When our mind makes contact with reality, it produces various feelings, sensations. And we then create our own version of reality, the world, based on our own and not others' feelings, or samsara. Based on those feelings, a desire for reality to be, quote unquote, the way we want it to be, occurs. We want to perpetuate some positive feeling or avoid some negative feeling, only to ultimately fail. We cannot make things reality by the way we want, based on our emotions. This is lack of drishti. This is suffering. So, I'm going to go down here, and it says, to summarize, the mind makes contact with reality. A feeling arises, either positive or negative. So we leave here, you get on the phone. Or you leave here and you go home. You're going to contact something. You're going to come into contact with something or somebody that's going to create and trigger a positive or a negative feeling. Okay? At that moment is when this practice has to start really kicking in, this thing that he's given us, you know, to go into sila, to go into the converse of suffering. So, we must stop the feeling before it becomes a desire. The trick is to not let our feelings escalate. And I found myself, you notice how if something happens and you don't like it, and you just keep on giving a story and documentary about it, and the more you do that, the more dissatisfied you become. You gotta shut that down. Don't let it go back over. Don't go back over it. It's happened. Don't keep going over and over, because it just builds more momentum, and there you're out of drishti. You just completely miserable. Okay? So, don't let it escalate. And then it says, the desire for things to be other than the way they are right now, right here, is suffering. If we lack drishti, we're going to suffer. That is the drishti or wisdom. It's really that simple. We are not able to maintain our mind in a state of no suffering. We will allow our mind to continue to operate in a state of suffering. It is the mind of suffering which must be overcome. We have become psychologically attached, and that's what I find for me, really, is attachment. I'm attached, and I remember him talking about attachment being a very subtle and insipid perversion. I'm attached to the thinking. I'm attached to consoling myself this way. I'm attached to thinking that I can figure something out, and I'm going to feel better about it, or it's going to make it all right. I'm attached to outcomes. So people have, you know, baby's daddy needs to be cooperating with me, and if he does this, then this, it'll be like this. But if he doesn't do that, you know, I'm all thrown out of whack. So I was attached to an outcome that didn't happen, didn't go the way I wanted it to go. Okay, so then again, their downfalls, more misery. Okay, so it says we are too busy suffering to practice not suffering. The vast majority of the souls, jivas, have been so trapped by Kalpurush, their awareness has become so low that they are doomed. They have no discrimination. They don't even know what real happiness is anymore. They have accepted pain and suffering as the only possibility for their life and living. So Vivek just can't even see. You know, sometimes I can, like I said, I can see, you know, the futility of involving myself with energy, time, and attention in this thing, and other times I get all caught up. Okay? So as stated above, there are three forms of suffering. There are also three forms of happiness. That's good to know. That's what I want to do. You know? So, So the sensual or worldly happiness, there's the sensual and worldly suffering. So the sensual worldly happiness is relief obtained by indulging the senses, i.e. money, food, sex, sleep, and bodily comfort. As stated above, there are three forms of suffering. There are also three forms of happiness. Okay. Happiness of concentration or samadhi, obtained by keeping the mind from making contact with reality, keeping the mind from going out by staying immersed in a state of inner tranquility. That's really where I want to get to, right there. Actually sitting this body down in the morning and being able to concentrate in samadhi. That's what I'd like to do. Okay? And then ultimate or spiritual happiness derived from knowing how to establish and maintain the mind in a state of no suffering. After you get up off the mat, keep that going, you know. So, negative feelings that arise in the mind pollute or defile the mind and create a state of inner turmoil. And we lose the ability to be at peace. Hope tip. The goal is to empty our mind of all its defilements, to attain a luminous and clear state of mind, nijman, and then maintain our mind in a state of luminosity. That's beautiful. When a defilement has arisen in the form of a negative feeling, we must throw it out. You don't remember anything else. I got to remember that. Throw it out. Throw it out. Just stop it right there. Immediately, by means of resorting to our mantra or other form of spiritual practice. There is no other way by which the happiness we are seeking can be attained. No fooling, no kidding. As Damo Sanantano. So, I mean, that's where I am. And one thing, thankfully, that has happened to me, even though I get caught up and I'm still ignorant and crazy, a shift happened for me a while back in terms of seeing things that are happening. There's nothing happening to me, per se. And I can't tell you how that's freed me. Even if it's something I don't want necessarily to be going that way, okay, it's not happening to me. I'm not a victim. Nobody's doing anything to me. This is the way it is. This is the way it's happening, you know, and I got to ride through that. Hopefully get to some Simran and Dion in the process, but everything is happening. Nothing's happening to us. Nobody's doing anything to us. And another part of this acceptance piece that I'm really having to get about myself and others is that, Master told me, nobody's operating at a place that they're not at. You can't operate any place but where you're at. That's only if something's happening and, you know, my ignorance is that I think it should be another way. Well, it's that way. That's based on where they are, based on where I am, you know. So I don't get all hung up in beating myself up that, okay, I'm sitting here and I'm not concentrating. Based on my understanding right now, because I'm still, you know, thinking that I can find some happiness in maintaining this body or getting this financial freedom or getting people to cooperate, you know. Saranja, you said that, and that, I'm going to love that word from now on, cooperate. In thing, that's a good, yeah, getting them to cooperate. I mean, I still get confused about that. I haven't been able to maintain Nijman or maintain Vivek. So, I mean, that's where I'm at. That's where it is. I have to be diligent and not, you know, sometimes, you know, get that little excuse making in there and go on and do what I want to do what the body or the mind dictates that I do at that moment, when I know it's going to either compound into something that's going to cause me more suffering, or it's certainly not going to do anything that's going to give me more wisdom. That's for doggone sure. You know what I mean? So I had to kind of weigh it like that. Okay, is it going to help me? Is it going to help me spiritually? Am I going to be worried about it on my deathbed? No. Okay, you know, those kind of questions, if you can, like the Dharma says there, if you can get a little bit of space in those moments. And this is all, can be something nobody else is even aware of. This is all in your head, in my head, you know. That's how subtle this thing is. And so, that's about all I have to say, I guess. It's so... I guess, you know, basic, but that's where I am. I don't know if anyone has questions or concerns or
we got questions.
Comments about anything.
Yeah, Kitty, but I want to say that you did say that, you know, because we is in America, whatever land they call this thing, but we kind of addicted to, you know, materialistic things, and you did say that the way that you avoid your suffering is by you shopping. So I say you got the path and the process help you kind of transcend through being addicted to Maya?
I have my cycles. Let me put it that way. I have my cycles of clarity, and then I have my cycles of real ignorance. But one thing Master did tell me about that I'm getting a little bit. I'm not there yet, but he told me, beloved, that you're doing things you do, is not so much what you're doing, but where it's coming from. So, you know, I have so much rolled up into that shop and so much invested in that, because that's also a part of, not only is it maladaptive to my suffering, but it's also a part of the vanity, or really the fear. It's really more about fear. I'm really fear of the fear of not being accepted, or the fear of getting old, or not having this image be this way. It's really fear-based, and it's become a habit. It's an addiction. And like I said, the more I'm able to realize that and maintain that, I'm able to not just go and compulsively shop. So I think now, 16 years later, I have I think that I don't just run to the store like I used to. You know what I mean? Like, if something happened, I just run. I mean, I can see how I did used to do that, to get that thing off me. You know what I mean? You get that thing off, whatever your thing is. You know, you're going to run. I don't tend to do that. I'm able to restrain, practice that sila a lot more. But, you know, I now say, okay, well,
I just buy a few things.
Big sale comes, you know, maybe twice a year, three times a year. I mean, I go. I mean, I really, you know. But I don't find myself, like, that's like more of a, I can't think of the word. Where I'm kind of building up to this point where I know, okay, I'm going shopping at this date because this is going to be a big sale, versus just running to the store. It's not making it right. It's still crazy. Running to the store, you know, on one day when I'm feeling something, you know. Not even aware, though, at that time. I am now. But I wasn't aware back then. You know, I'm running there to get this thing off me. You know what I mean? Let me go drown in some racks and look and see if I can find something. You know what I mean? Or drown in your cigarette, drown in your drug, drown in your food, right. Whatever you're drowning in. Right. You know what I mean? You're doing that to get that thing off, but then you gotta pay. You're gonna have to pay. You're gonna have to pay down the line, somewhere, some way. You're gonna have to pay. So then, in that moment, if you can see that you're getting ready to go there, grab hold to that practice. You know what I mean? And even if you, like I said, I'm not able to completely have the Vivek, I can at least hold off on that episode. You know what I mean? I can hold off that time, you know, until I can build some more wisdom. Just keep building. He said wisdom with practice. Wisdom and practice. Just keep building some more. And use that seal of restraint. So, you know, I would say that restraint is something all of us have to do, because we're all addicted to something. So, yeah. Yeah. Anybody?
Faraji.
Faraji, you have a look on your face like you're getting ready to say something.
Faraji.
Oh, Faraji. Okay. You know
the
Faraji, yes.
You know how you say this is where we are, and an individual is just where they are. I even like the build up. I hold off and I build up. Have you found that that in itself has become a strategy in order to let us off the hook, to maybe not move ourselves to the level and where we need to be, and or to even move to that next level? If I consistently say that, you know, this is where I am, this is what, you know, it have you found that potentially can become another strategy?
Of course
you
can. That's why I have a guru. But, you know what I mean? Yeah, definitely. There's going to be some things that I won't see, but all I can do is look back in time and see from where I've come. He said, always be looking, examining, you know. And if there's progression, you know, he talks about these things that we hope for. I don't know if it's in this, but, you know, we want these feelings of joy. We want the feeling of, you know, all these positive qualities in our life. And if I can see that I'm gaining more of that, you know what I mean, in my life and living, I am moving in the right direction. But yeah, I'm definitely going, ego's always, I just told you, I'm sit up and, you know, I've rationalized, you know, I'm going to watch this television show, knowing good and doggone well. So yeah, I would rationalize anything, whether it be shopping or anything else. And as I was saying that, I told you, I know it's still crazy, but it is a little more restrained. You know what I mean? I have a handle on it. But the rebellion, the ignorance and the insanity, you know, is still there whenever I fall, for sure. Does that answer? No. Okay, so what do you want me to say? I didn't answer it, okay?
Saying that you're in the moment, that you are where you are, he said, asking you, is that a strategy that we fall back on and don't deal with things?
An excuse.
Didn't I say that?
You answered it in your way.
You answered it.
I don't know what else to say about that, but I know this mind here has all kinds of ways.
But I think the part when you said you got a group, that's who helps us not.
I mean, not be deluded about it.
Right.
I mean that.
The other.
If I didn't have one for sure, huh?
The other Radhasis too.
Most definitely, the gift.
Yes. Yes.
Your gift here, this gift to me and each other. I mean, it's without it. Oh, yeah, I'd be all, I mean, you know. Yes.
You mentioned a few times, you didn't really go into it, but you mentioned about this fear. Have you went into that fear to kind of see what that fear is? Have you been able to identify and flush out what that fear is?
Well, the retreat helped me really start pulling that up, but I need to keep right on it. Is what really needs to happen. And the fear, yes, I see all the fears as it relates to the worldly concerns, where I'm at with those. So my actions are fear-based. I'm afraid of the acceptance, the image, losing the image. Well, the image is going to go because I'm not going to stay 25. So I'm not going to have the same image. You see what I'm saying? So I'm seeing that these activities are fear-based. And the retreat really pulled them up to the thing. So, but I have to keep looking. Yeah, I got to keep on pushing and keep it there. Because it's not something you want, you know. I don't necessarily want to always say I'm, you know, doing something that I don't like. But I try to do things. I mean, I know that's what this process is. Go in there, run in that burning building, you know. And have everybody here to, you know, pour some water on me. You know what I mean? Everybody. Because I'm not trying to run. I'm not trying to hide. But that's, you know, that's the whole pair. That's the hard part of this thing. You know, we got this lower self that wants to do what it wants to do.
Yes.
Ignorant and crazy as hell.
Yes.
And then, yet we snap in and say, oh my God, what do you, you know. So it's always that battle for me. It's always that battle for me. And, you know, I'm not enlightened by any means, so I'm still definitely ignorant and crazy. But, he said it's in here and there's so much of me that does understand that. I think so many of us. No, I don't think anybody that's here doesn't understand that, or you wouldn't even be doing this. You know, I think, anyway. But, you know, yeah, it's a lot of fear that still has to be kept in the forefront of my mind, you know, kept there and dealt with moment to moment, moment to moment, and every action, you know, because this is plane of action. So with every action, is my action fear-based? Am I doing something based out of fear or based out of love? Which is it, you know? So yeah, I always have to be looking at that, and I'm still looking. Yes.
Does considering your death and dying have anything to do with helping you, or have you used it, or and how have you had this help you?
I remember when Master has to do this thing where you consider your loved ones and their deaths and all that, and that's hard to do, but it was okay. But I think considering my own death, that when my mother passed, that helped me actually pull some stuff up and say, okay, let me get all this in order here so that you all, you know, if this happens to me, this, this, and this. It did help. I would say probably for me, though, it's more about knowing that I'm just not happy and knowing that I'm aging. I don't think that the death part for me is as strong, though it's there, as the process to the death, to the, you know what I mean? The things that are happening, that are changing, that I'm seeing day to day, as much as the death in and of itself. But that is ultimately, you know, what the philosophy says that we are afraid of, that I'm afraid of death. You know, I'm afraid of dying. So philosophically, yes, I understand that. But what is real for me and what I see is helping me to have some dristy is to understand that everything is impermanent. You know, the other things to impermanence, the other parts, relationships are going to die. This body is going to change, you know, all these kind of things. For me, that's helped me a lot, probably more.
Glad to hear it.
I wasn't going to ask, but I'm just curious. If you have that big sale, say in May or June, what are you doing between now and that date?
Getting ready.
Are you putting your money together and planning what you're going
to buy? No. No, it's so habitual. I just know. No, I don't think.
Tell the truth.
I'm not certainly not saving any money. That's why I don't have any financial freedom. So I'm not doing that. I don't have any money to save. No. I'll just spend. No.
Never mind.
Yeah, I know you were picking me but being funny at the picking me at the same time. I understand what you're saying. No, I'm not fantasizing about it. I'm not waiting for it to happen. But I think that I never even
thought about it.
No, I never thought of it like that. I just know when the sales are. It's just so maybe so far in my subconscious I don't even think about it. It just bam. It's February. You know what I mean? I don't even.
Absolutely.
You know, it's some scar. I'll come. I'm gonna think on that some more. Yes.
What I'm taking from his question and kind of what I'm curious about as well is if you say that shopping is one of your major consultants and you're practicing restraint on time, is it really restraint or are you really consulting yourself in another way? And if so, what other ways are you using to console yourself at that moment because you're putting off the shopping?
Right, if it's going into something else. The only thing that I tend to do compulsively that I'm aware of for the most part is the shopping. I will compulsively snack and I might do some compulsive TV watching that I can think of. You know what I mean? Like, okay, well, I can't, well, let me go watch this movie, you know, let me go watch this show.
Yeah, I mean, because why I ask that is because if in a moment you're feeling sad or hurt or whatever the case may be, you're not going to say, I could be happy 3 months from now when the sale is on. You go do something at that moment. And so I'm saying.
Well, I'm applying the practice. That's what I'm trying. I mean, my wisdom is deepening. That's why I'm not as prone to it. You see what I'm saying? As I used to be. Where I'm finding that the whole drama and intoxication with the shopping, with the image, with the, all this stuff that's not real. Okay, but you see what I'm saying? I'm shattering that more so. So I'm having some Vivek. I'm having some understanding about, okay, well, you know what? You know, you go and shop, just like I know he was talking about, okay, what kind of process, step-by-step process of self-talk do you need to do to get yourself into a different place? On one of the, was the last workshop or, I don't know if it's Satsang, he was talking about somebody wanting to go have sex with somebody. He said, well, you know, you can weigh it. You know what I mean? You can go and.
What are the dangers?
Yeah, you can go weigh it and say, okay, well, you know, if I do this, you know, she's going to be frustrated. I'm going to go to sleep. Yeah. I'm out of $65. Then I got to go to lie. You know what I mean? So if I have to, I'll take myself through those kind of steps. in those kind of moments that I'm aware of. But I find myself being able to be more clear on some things in terms of having some dristy about some things, weighing it. I either weigh, I'm saying, okay, I get the dristy. I say, is it that big of a deal that somebody didn't do what I wanted them to do, so that that would cause this emotional chain, you know, reaction, and I go out here and do this? You know what I mean? So at the moment that something is happening, is where the change is happening. It's not that, but it's at the moment that something's happening in my day-to-day life, you see what I'm saying, that I'm addressing, which then brings that kind of impulse or compulsivity, puts it to bed, makes it rest, okay? So what I was saying about the thing that I'm, in a little bit of me, is understanding how Master's saying, you know, it's not so much of what you're doing, it's where it's coming from. So like he was saying, well, you know, King Jonica, all these kings had all these fine things, but they weren't of that. You see what I'm saying? They had that, but they weren't confused. So I'm trying to become clear and sane about the connection to it and not be connected with it, even though I might have that thing. So, you know, I'm in it. I'm just in it. But at the point of the problem of lack of dristy or not having things the way I want, not accepting reality is where the problem is. That's the byproduct. So I'm working on this so that that becomes different. You know what I mean? Yes.
I'm kind of getting from what you're saying. It's like being in that super mega mall of the universe, and you're lost, and you finally see a sign saying you are here. Without being having that center to know that you're here, how can you get out?
Mm-hmm. Well, that's,
you know, so that's what I'm getting.
Yeah, from being aware of it.
Right.
Being
at
aware
least being aware.
Because
it's
like,
start.
Yeah. Because I mean, I have had several instances where I would feel like, and then I'm aware now. Ooh, let me go turn the car, and I don't. I said, no. Oops. You know. You know what I mean?
Right.
And keep on going. Let that thing subside. That's just a desire. Right. It will vanquish, you know.
Right.
So if you don't, yeah, if you're not even aware of it, man oh man, you don't have a choice, really. You really don't have a choice.
Right.
Yeah. It'll be a hindsight thing, and then at
right.
that point,
already
happened. Yeah. Yeah. Did that answer it for Raj? Still didn't answer. Of course not.
Never satisfied.
Never.
Yeah,
never.
Can't
have
the
way he wants. I know. We do know that. Perpetually. Yes. Anything else? And now you said that, were you saying that in about yourself, knowing that you, like, ooh, I was just there and didn't realize it?
No,
for
you
yourself
saying,
or for me? I mean, is
no,
that something?
No, you were using the terminology, the reference of shopping, and
mm-hmm.
I'm just saying, well, that happened to me. I didn't want to be there, but I was in the Mall of America, man, hopelessly lost. Oh, I can't find her. I can't find the parking lot, and it was a sign that said, you were here. I was like, whoa, man,
oh.
If it wasn't for this, I was done. You know, so it gave me a reference point to at least show me, to point the direction to where I needed to go.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
That's what I was kind of comparing that to what you
I
were
see.
Saying.
But that's a good analogy. I mean, that's for any.
Well, see, you were saying shopping so much, that kid, man, I remember I was lost in that mall.
You are here, yeah, I like that.
So now, yeah, where are we lost? Where? What are you lost in? You know, what are you lost in? No. What are you, I'm talking about mental state. What mental state are you lost in that gets you, you know, to a place where then you, you know, regret in hindsight, or you've done something that caused you more suffering. Now you got me saying shopping. Suffering. You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
So everybody, that's a perfect analogy. Where are you? I know, yeah, where I'm focusing on me, but that's a question for everybody. That's a good little, yeah, it's a good little strategy or tool to use, you know, to see where you're at. So anybody have anything else? Yes.
Mm-hmm. Do you find that your approach to making yourself aware changes in accordance with the situation at hand? So the shopping is one example. You're driving there,
mm-hmm.
you know, thinking about that. An alternative, let's say you're in a heated conversation with someone and you'd like them to respond the way that you want,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
that you want them to.
Mm-hmm.
Does your strategy change? Sit down, please. Sit down. Does your strategy change at that moment? What is your approach to handling things, let's say, outside of the context of maybe shopping or something to that?
Well, in terms of interpersonal relationships, I've been able to, maintain some functionality with some people that I may not have been able to do that before. Okay, I'm able to not be right. I'm able to defer. I'm able to hear their perspective. And though it may not jive what I think, which is not going to probably be right anyway, you know, I'm able to give that space. So if there's an understanding that I have, you know, and have had in some personal, interpersonal relationships. And boy, I tell you, like Master said, some jihad, because when some stuff happens and that ego wants to reboot, you see what I'm saying? To be able to not act on that, it's a beautiful thing to feel that and to do that. You know what I mean? Because the rebooting is going to cause another problem, you see? So I'm able to, you know, have perfected it, but I have come along. I'm becoming functional now. I'm becoming a long way with being able to hear others, to accept that, you know what I mean? And then move on. Now, there's some reality in terms of if something's happening that I got to respond to it, then I got to, you know, at that. But you know, gotcha. Argument on opinions, I mean.
Who cares?
Yeah.
Anybody else?
Okay, well, then I guess that I am finished. I hope, Master, I hope you somewhat pleased. I don't know. But anyway, that's it for me. If,
do you have another song?
I don't know
song?
How you end it. Oh, yes, I have another song. The
I was nothing, I was nowhere to
check.
Walk out.